If an alien ever bursts out of my chest, for my last request, I want you to name the alien sand word. I don't want to give an explanation. That's
I'm
just,
not trying to do that.
yeah, you should. That's my last request. Be a boy.
I'm going to deny your last request.
You don't want to name the alien sand word?
No, I would kill the alien and bury it in a box, like a metal box, so it can't get away even if it
That's
comes
my
back to life.
child.
No.
Welcome to the Loincloth Hour.
Welcome. I just we're starting now.
I guess.
Welcome to the Loincloth Hour. This is a podcast where I, Manicorn, aka Super Goblin, aka Croup, and my partner Sid talk about
Hi.
old cartoons and what we like about them, especially the day stuff.
Yes, this is a
I
podcast.
just called you my partner. I don't know if that's weird. My podcast partner.
That's not weird. So, last we left off, it
Yes,
was
previously on Gargoyles.
previously on Galorbadors. We left off on Goliath returning to Castle Wyvern in, what was it, 939, 940 AD?
994 AD. And the reason I know that is because they travel 1,000. I'm spoiling shit already for this episode.
What we've already established that. Okay, you know what? Whatever. So 994 AD, Goliath returns to Castle Wyvern to see the castle's in ruins, and he comes across a pile of dust he thinks is Demona, and he's like just
Well,
angsting
who
on
else
top
can
of
it be? It's like it's in the spot that Demona ha always hangs out at, like when she
yeah,
turns to stone.
like
It's
Demona,
her
like
spot.
she's dead.
She's definitely
We didn't
dead.
even learn her real name,
Like,
which
okay, but like, real talk though, why is that pile of rubble there? Because we know it isn't Demona. Not to spoil even more things.
dude, I don't know. Maybe Hakon got
Like, is that
messy.
somebody else's gargoyle, or did like, did she put a fake statue there to be crushed while she just went and like hung out under the cliffs?
I don't even
What is
remember,
going
like,
on?
why didn't she get destroyed again? Like, where was she during this?
Okay, well, I believe it will be revealed like next season that she just went and hid out like
Not next
under the cliff
season.
face. No, isn't it? It's in the City of Stone, the four-parter. I think she
Oh,
like
it's
it's
revealed
really
then.
explained
Okay, no,
finally.
yeah. All
Yeah,
right.
I think so.
Okay, because I was like, no, she's not
But
gonna.
all we got until like we get like several versions of what happens, but it's they're all bullshit until like that version, which I'm pretty sure is like when she finally just told the truth.
I don't know. We'll get there when we get there.
Well,
Well,
we're
baby
gonna find
steps.
out. Like,
Baby steps.
listeners, hang tight, and we will eventually get there, and not only remember what
Okay.
happened, but we'll guide you through it as well.
So, Awakening Part 2. We begin when Goliath and Hudson get back to the castle, and I already talked about all this. Like, Goliath is on top, angsting over what he thinks is a dead Demona. Hudson's already down investigating the situation, and he says in
You
this
said he's
very.
on top. It's like on top of what? I assume you mean on top of the castle, but it's funny because never mind. You know what?
Goliath,
Let's just cut all of this
he's not a
out.
top. Come on.
Goliath is. You're right. Oh my god.
He's a
He's
bottom. I mean, he was with
a blushing
Demona.
bottom.
Like, come
Like,
on.
yeah, he was like, looked at his choice of lovers.
Yeah. Like, there's no way around it. So, and
Imagine
Hudson
topping
is
anybody with
off
one.
at the bottom area of the castle, investigating the situation, and he says in this very sultry Scotland older gargoyle voice, you know, how he talks, and he's just like these bowstrings were cut, there was betrayal here. And off to
Right,
this.
like he's putting the pieces together.
Yeah, no, yeah, he's like, you know, just imagine Hudson in this, like, Columbo outfit with, like, a monocle, and he's just like,
Oh my God, I would
he's
watch that
Sherlock
show.
Holmes, you know?
One more question. That was my Columbo impression.
That was pretty good. That was cute. I like that. And I'm just going through my notes at the moment. Off to the side, because I took a lot of notes this episode. I outdid myself compared to
Oh my
last
God.
one.
I took more notes this time than I did last time, and I didn't think that would happen.
My
But
God,
I got like into the groove,
this
I
is just
think.
like we're contesting at this point. This is just this
Yeah,
podcast
like
is
I took
really.
more notes than you did. No, I took more notes than you did.
This is Sid in post-editing, and for those of you listening, there's going to be some slight static interference with my voice now and then. I just ordered a new microphone so that it doesn't happen again for future episodes, but just bear with it. It comes and goes now and then, just forewarning you because it is noticeable. Thank you for listening, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the podcast. Hudson is like, he finds out that there was betrayal here because the bowstrings were cut, and off to the
Yes,
side,
because he's a smart guy.
he is a smart guy. He's an old, just one of them good old
He's
boys.
not just a himbo. Like, there's a brain underneath all that pretty face.
God, he's got such a he does have a very pretty face, just the scar, and he's got the beard going on.
Oh
He's
my
just
God, Scott,
he's
beard,
he's
the
he
ruggedness.
the ruggedness.
He's
He's
the full package.
an attractive man. He's just got it going on. Age like a
Like, he's what
fine
I
wine.
aspire to be when I'm that old.
I didn't
As
like
this
what I
is
just
happening, I believe the doors to the rookery open and the trio come out.
They do. And Goliath swoops down and asks them if there were any more down in the rookery, but they respond with there were not, and they're all just like in the wake of this
They all
travesty.
look so depressed. Yeah, like they're looking around, like in shock. I at this point, I also noticed that the animation is noticeably less good than it was last episode. Like,
I'm gonna
not to throw any shade, but like, did you notice that though?
I did, no, and I'm gonna get into that once we reach a certain point, because
Oh, okay.
you probably already guessed. You probably have no idea, but just like we'll get there when we get there. So it's
Oh,
like,
okay. I'm looking forward to what happens.
yes. So at this point, Goliath is hell bent on just avenging what has happened here. They were like wronged beyond belief. There's tension, there's angst. You can feel it protruding through the characters. And
Yeah, I think he even has a great line where he's like, "And we will have our revenge."
he
And he
does. He
like
has a
shouts
really
it.
great line where he says that. Yes.
I enjoy any time he talks about revenge because it's just really
Oh,
hot
yeah.
for me for some reason.
Just like, that you get that sort of
I think that's a kink that I have.
you like angsty buff men.
Yeah. I have a type.
You do have a type. So Goliath and the group fly off from the castle looking for the Vikings, and then we
Right.
just get
Like,
this.
they all fly off one at a time. Which I thought was funny, but I don't know why.
That is, no, you're right, it is funny. And what I thought was funniest was just like while they're flying off, we get the shot of just Bronx, the dog gargoyle, just on all fours following behind them. And I'm just like thinking, that's gotta be annoying to just have to do that.
Like, throughout this entire show's production, and like it starts here, I always feel like Bronx is just a complete afterthought to like the writers. Like, they always forget he exists. And
Yeah.
then I feel like some guy at like the last second was like, "Wait, we forgot about the dog," and like some intern had to go and draw it in
Oh
of
my
Bronx
gosh.
running after them.
That's honestly valid. There are times where I'm talking about, like just the main group, and I completely forget Bronx exists. I'm
Like,
not saying he's
he never
useless. I'm
does
just
anything,
saying.
and like most of the time they're up, like they live up in a high place, and like Bronx can't go. Like, do they take Bronx for walks? Like, he's all cooped up there. He can
That
never go
I think
anywhere.
that is established at some point, because I do remember one episode where I don't know, that's a spoiler though. So, there's something I gotta talk about. I put it in a nice lengthy paragraph. We cut to the Viking group, and they're just having a rollicking good time around the fire after having successfully overthrown Castle Wyvern. There's just, laughter and noogieing, a bunch of guys just having a real guy time, and
Yeah, drinking, carousing.
We've all had those kind of nights. And then we pan to the side, we see there's like a few Viking soldiers overlooking like the human hostages, the prisoners. And then I'm sorry, this is gonna get weird, but There's
God.
one just background Viking overlooking the hostages, and I notice he's not wearing any shoes. He's just completely barefoot, and
Oh my God.
I'm thinking to myself, why is he not wearing boots or shoes? He even has leg bracelets on his knees, but he's just like foot naked. Like,
Now, you see, I didn't notice that, but you did. And I think there's a reason that you did and I didn't.
oh God, there is. I'm just listen. And I think to myself, wouldn't it have been easier for the animators to just draw shoes instead of having to design a whole dude's just bare ass leg model? Or is it like BioWare where they
God.
model and design the characters naked first and then draw the clothing on? Because that would make sense in that sense.
I can't believe we saw this man's bare ankle in this children's television show. Like, don't they know what this is gonna do to all those kids out there?
Honestly, like it's just like on scene for like a couple seconds, and he's just like big and burly and bearded, and he's just like not wearing shoes.
Have to go
And
and find this guy now because I did not notice this.
I had a sensory activation when I saw it. I'm like, wait.
Oh my God.
And I had to pause and just take notes. But then we look cut to the human hostages, and we see precious boy Tom telling his mother that, oh, the gargoyles will come and save us, and the mother's just like fucking bawling her eyes out, and she's
Yeah,
just
she's
like,
like, kid, they're fucking dead, little boy. Like, they're not coming to save anybody.
and Tom is just kind of like surprised and in disbelief upon hearing this, because of course, he's like, the gargoyles are just like super badass. Why would that? That's not
Yeah.
possible.
He's like their number one fanboy, which I think is adorable because he
I
knew them for like all of
love
10
Tom.
seconds last episode.
Yeah, like he's just
Tom's the
great.
best. Like, and these people are refugees. Like, I don't think we touched on this last episode, but they, I don't even know where they're from, but they were like at Castle Wyvern as refugees already. So
Oh,
now that
yeah.
castle's been sacked and they've all been like taken prisoner. It's like they've
Yeah.
not had a happy time of it lately, Tom, his mom, and all these other people who we see like in like just having blankets around themselves. That's like the classic refugee look
They're
for
all just wearing
television.
like rags and stuff. And then we pan over further out to the cave where I guess Hakon lives. I don't
It's
know.
like his headquarters.
That's
He
his
just hangs out in
home.
this cave.
He lives, he's a
He
caveman.
is a cave, man.
And we, the first thing we see just on screen is just the princess and the magus having these resting bitch faces as they're tied up. They're the
They
most.
do. They're like, are you serious right now? Like, this is what we're doing today?
They're the most annoying hostages ever. And I'm gonna get into that, but like, my God, they just are unpleasant to be around in any situation.
It's like they're just not having a good time being held hostage by Vikings for some reason. Like, I'm astounded that they're feeling this way.
Honestly, like I honestly cackled as soon as I saw them. I'm just like, oh my God. But yeah,
This is
and
also the first time, this is the first bondage scene in the show, which I'm amazed by that they put like this woman and this twink in bondage before like any of the buff guys.
Honestly,
Because like
that's
normally it's the opposite.
almost a
Like there is more like
travesty.
muscle man bondage in this show than I can ever get over. But like this is the first time that we get any in this
Yeah,
these
but
two.
this doesn't count because like they're not hot. They're just wearing just like weird robes and shit.
It does count.
Shush. You don't tell me. Anyways, so we zoom out, and the guard captain is just kind of looking down at them as they're tied up. And in the background is just a super relaxed Hakon sitting with his legs spread, all sultry like.
Yeah, he's totally man spreading on his like his throne that he has.
And
And
you
I don't know
can.
if you noticed this, but he's definitely checking out the guard captain's ass. Am I the only
No.
one who saw that?
I definitely noticed that
It's like in right in front of his face, and like he's just looking at it. Like he's not looking at the prisoners. He's just like, I'm gonna just look at this beefy butt in front of
See,
me
it's like
instead.
whatever they were up to since their victory, he's satisfied about it, you know.
Oh my God. Yeah, I am almost 100% sure that at this point that they have like a sexual relationship. They've become lovers now, like evil lovers.
Yeah, it's like, it's kind of like a like a hate fuck, love hate kind of thing, because like, you know, there's some angst in their relationship or whatever, but like,
There,
yeah.
yeah, there is some things that they need to work out between them. Like, it's a rocky relationship right now, but it is a relationship.
Really, the problem with the relationship is they're both fucking idiots. They don't plan things out, and that's why they're so good together.
Well, they're sort of planning things out right now, though, because Hakon is going like, the Metis is worth more alive than dead,
Yeah, okay.
barely. Like, they're talking about like prisoners and what to do with them, which it is funny that they haven't talked about this like beforehand. And then they're talking about like ransoming the princess and how her uncle the king will
Okay.
pay handsomely
Yes, all right.
and all
So
this.
I really thought about that line, 'cause now we see like where her title and royalty comes up, like, oh, her uncle happens to be the king. But okay, a couple things. One, why is this quote princess unquote in just this castle by herself far off from wherever the king is? Two, is you being the niece or nephew of royalty technically entitling you as like a princess or prince? I looked it up, and
I have no idea.
I looked it up, and apparently it just depends on the type of royalty and the region. So it's really just
Hold
up
on,
in the air.
wasn't her father the king though? And then he died? Is that what happened?
If that happened, it wasn't clear in the episode.
Yeah, like I don't pretend to understand like the royal family's like family tree.
I don't fucking know,
It's all
dude.
just a bunch of right, so
They're like, I
you know,
don't.
if she wants to call herself a princess, then she can be a princess, like whatever,
I
sweetie. You can call
that makes
yourself
me
what
dislike her more. I really hate the term princess because it just provides off this
that old Zelda
brattiness.
cartoon where Link is like, "Well, excuse me,
Excuse
princess."
me, princess. God. There's just ugh. Anyways, long story short, I can't stand either of these characters, and they're both like in
Yeah, like
bondage.
we already disliked them, and now they're even more annoying because they're basically just bitching the whole time.
So, they're both tied up. They're talking about ransom stuff, and the Magus just shouts like at the guard captain, like, "You blackguard!" Whatever that means, or blackguard, whatever.
You
What does
blackguard.
he say?
It's blackguard. It's like an old-timey insult.
I don't know what that means. I should have
It's
looked that
basically
up.
he's calling the guard captain an asshole.
Oh, well, just call him an asshole. What a priss. Like, he's got to be so up and mighty with his tone, which I'm going to talk about that with another character later when he gets introduced, but I just hate characters who sound like they're smarter than they actually are.
Yeah, because the thing with the mage is like I normally like characters like him. Like I
Yeah.
like wizards and stuff, but like I can't like the mage just because he's such a dumbass.
No,
He's
yeah,
very upsetting to
I
me.
have such distaste for the Magus. I pretty much everybody in that cave right now is expendable in my eyes. They're just all idiots, except for, of course,
Okay, but Hakon's at least hot, right?
Hakon is at least hot. So is
Like
the guard
he has some
captain.
redeeming value. Yeah, we have the two hotties.
Like that's their only redeeming qualities that makes me like them more than the Magus and the Princess, is that they're both these hot dad types. But yeah, so anyways, the Magus swears, or quote, swears unquote at Hakon and the guard captain, and Hakon does this very cliche but boisterous villain laugh. You know, he's like, ha ha ha, and he's sitting all spread legged and
Yeah,
all.
well, Mages is all like, if I had my book of spells,
Yeah.
I'd.
And then he's all, "You mean this book of spells?" And he just fucking pulls it out and rifles through the pages in front of him. And it's like, I know we don't like the Magus, but I. With the animation, I adore how meme-worthy his expressions are. He's just
Oh
got
my God,
this.
because his face got like really stretchy all of a sudden.
Yeah.
He's had
Like,
a very long face.
he does. No, it's like, because he has such elvish features and he's not like as, designed as like the others are with like, their beards and their lines on their faces. Like, the Magus just literally has just eyeliner and resting bitch face, and that's his whole expression. So it's like, when we see him, like, you know, act
That's
like...
his entire personality.
Honestly, and he manifests it well in that sense. But the way his expressions come to light, it's hard to explain. He looks like he reminds me of the prince from Cinderella 3. You know, like
The one who jumped out the window.
He looks like
That's all I know about Cinderella 3 is that one scene. Does it always that's like memed?
Long story short, he looks like 2000s worthy memes, like just stills and everything. Like, you can probably just scroll through the screenshots I sent you and see what I'm talking about. Just
You
his
sent me,
face
I
is
think you
just
sent me like
funny.
9 just of the Mage's face.
Yeah, I don't
It
know.
is funny. He's so crispy and like, yeah.
I don't know. We are twink discriminating right now. We have to stop this for all the good twinks
it's
out
going to
there.
continue for the whole rest of the show.
No, it is. It is.
But that's okay, because, you know, there's room for every sort of body on television and in our podcast. It's just we have biases towards beefcakes.
So.
Or at least I do.
Anyways, moving forward. Hakon says my favorite line he says in the show, where he's just
Oh my
like,
God.
magic spells, ha! Makes me glad I can't read. And I'm just like, oh my
God.
It's
like, illiteracy is cool. And then he starts just taking pages out and like throwing them
he's
into the
such
fire.
a jock bully, like, my God. He's so stupid.
Yeah. It's like, they made us hate the Magus last episode, but like, I feel like for this episode, this is like the establishing scene that's supposed to make us hate Hakon. And, you know, as something of a bibliophile, like, it worked. Like, seeing people, someone burning a book, like, just gets this visceral, like, anger from me. I'm like, stop, don't do that, no. Like, I feel bad when I see that.
I thought it was funny. I was
Oh
just
my
like...
God.
I mean, it's just because I'm gushing, because I know he's voiced by freaking Clancy Brown. I like his voice, and I find Hakon attractive and stuff. But really, that's why I was, you know, very attention-centered to this is so stupid when he was burning the book. I'm just like, God, what a meme. But no, he
Like,
starts
I
burning
was
the
probably
book.
it's imagining like all the books that I read as a kid, because, you know, they were like my escape from the real world as a child. I was very much a book worm.
Oh, I was too.
So just, you know, seeing any disrespect towards books at all, I get so that I'm not upset about what happens to Hakon later in this episode.
Oh, no. I mean, like, Hakon, if anyone deserves it, it's probably him. Or, you know, the Magus. Nudge, nudge, but it's like... he's burning this book, and the Magus is just, you know, having a little, you know, temper tantrum, like, no! And you know what comes to mind when he's burning this book and the Magus is freaking out? You ever watch, I'm just gonna keep bringing up memes, but you ever watch Sharkboy and Lava Girl?
Like, when it first came out, but that was a while
that
ago.
That scene where the kid's like, he ruined my dream journal!
Oh my God.
That's all I was thinking during that scene. And, you know, credit to you. You were upset about the demolishing of precious text, but, I mean, he did it for the lulz. And that's...
I feel like he does most of his stuff for the lulz.
He does, yeah.
And this Viking raider.
That's, you know, that's a part of why I adore him as a villain. So, the princess is getting pissy as well. And she's like,
I'll
see
you both
both
hang
for
this.
This. And that's when Hakon stops, you know, lolling around and gets all like, don't vex me, princess, or I'll see it's your neck.
Is that this point in the episode, too? I noticed that the animation had gotten better.
Yeah.
Like, I think they got like the B team for like just that first scene, but the rest of this episode like looks as good as the first one did, I think.
So I think what it is like, you have the exposition animation where it's like they really don't care. They just want to like progress the story. And then you have the
Very,
action
like,
animation.
Yeah, you're probably right. Because coming right up after this, there's this insane gargoyle scream that we hear of like all the like Goliath and friends all just screaming at once and like falling out of the sky.
Yes, and then the Vikings are all like, "Oh, they're coming! Run for your lives!" And like, Hakon looks fucking afraid when he starts hearing this shit. Like, this is a guy who is like actively just like pissing his pants right now.
Yeah,
And
well, he turns to the Dark Captain. He's like, "You said they wouldn't follow us." And
oh
the
my
Dark Captain
God.
is like, "Well, if you hadn't fucking destroyed their entire clan, they probably wouldn't have, dipshit."
They're so stupid. Like, there's no brain cells in that room.
Okay, but can you explain this? Okay, so they go outside, they see the gargoyles coming, then they go back into the cave, and now Hakon like grabs the princess. And he's going to kill her, it looks like. Like, why did his plans just change all of a sudden?
No. What it was the Magus being a fucking dumbass and misreading the whole situation. So Hakon goes inside to grab the princess because she's the most like she's like the number one hostage, and he thinks
Right.
that if he has her with him, that'll, probably not get him fucking killed by the gargoyles.
Oh, is that what he's gonna see? Because he has like a knife up to her, it looks
No,
like.
because she was
Like, it
like
seemed like he was just gonna be like, "Oh, they're here to save you? Well, I'll make sure that they can't, because I'll just kill you first."
that was him being like threatening, I read it as, but
Okay, that does make
anyways,
more sense.
yes. And so it's like she's like, "Oh, the gargoyles are coming. You're a dead man, Hakon." And I'm just like, "Bitch, were you just not criticizing the hell out of them their entire time you were
And so
living
she,
with
this
them?"
from this, she was racist as hell up until like 2 minutes ago, and now she's like, "Oh, I believe in the gargoyles." It's like,
That's
girl,
because they're
who are you
literally
trying to fool
you.
exactly?
Her rate. Okay, hot take. Not a hot take. It's everything that's happening right now is literally because she was racist.
Is, yeah, like she's constructed this whole situation,
Pretty
like not the
much.
Viking raiding part, but like everything else is pretty much her fault.
So, and so yeah, no, she's telling him they're gonna wreck your shit because, oh, suddenly she believes in the gargoyles now that they're pretty much screwed. And Hakon is just like, maybe. And he's like, but, and then he pulls out a knife. And I do like those brief frames where he pulls out the knife, because it's he looks
Right.
really like sinister and stuff. I'm just like thinking,
Because
oh.
you're just turned on by any man who's like threatening or dangerous looking. You're just turned on by.
I am.
Let's keep it real.
I am.
But
I'm That's me reading
then the
into it.
princess like fucking like body checks him like while she's tied up, and she just runs out of the fucking cave.
She
She's like,
does.
"I'm out. Goodbye." Yeah. She like tackles him with her shoulder, and then Hakon like falls into the guard captain's arms, like
Yes, and he falls.
very, if you screen cap it, it's like very romantic looking,
He
like they're
falls
holding each
very
other.
gracefully into his arms, like he was meant to be there. Let's see. And the
More
Magus starts
evidence.
freaking out, and I think personally it's because the Magus is like a vanilla kinkster and he's never seen knife play before. He's never seen a guy
Oh my
pull
God.
out knives before, and he starts freaking out.
Like
He's like,
being tied up is already like the limit of his kink play. He's like, no, like this is already like as kinky as I can get.
yeah, so the princess is running off, and Hakon and the guard captain start chasing after her. And the Magus is just like having a spaz attack in the fucking cave. And he starts like, I guess, like rubbing his ropes against like a rock or something. And it's just like, why didn't you do that sooner?
Well, it's because he's useless. But in his defense, I hate that I'm defending the mages. Like he was being watched up until this point. Like this is his first time being alone, I
Oh yeah,
think.
that's
So
true.
he's
I
just
don't
like,
know.
okay, I'll fuck that
I'm
easily.
just like,
We just like to talk shit about the
I'm dishing
mages.
on the Magus any chance I get. You know that scene from Always Sunny where like Mac is like, he's got those historical figures up on the board. He's like putting like
I've had enough of this
these
guy.
the, not that scene, but yes, that too.
Oh, wait, I know. Okay, the one they're talking about evolution.
Yeah, and like, he's
Science
calling
bitches.
Aristotle a bitch, and then he puts like the sticker on his face. That's like us with the Magus right
Yeah,
now.
it is.
But also the "I've had enough of this dude" clip. Because I don't know. So, anyways, organize my
There's a
notes here.
fun little fight after this, I think. Like all the gargoyles. sort of swoop in. Goliath sees Hakon and the captain running after the princess.
Yes.
And he flies after them. But the rest of the Gargoyles just stay and, like, fuck shit up.
Yeah, that's no, what they're, good they're all kicking Viking ass. And, hey, guess what the first thing Broadway fucking does is?
He picks up a piece of meat and beats someone up with it.
He immediately goes for the piece of chicken being roasted over, like, the fire. And he picks it up. A Viking is about to, like, fuck his shit up. And what Broadway does with this piece of meat is he fucking clubs this dude out of existence. Like a fucking, like, Tiger Woods golf move shit.
He defeats him.
He's obliterated. I mean, in Broadway's defense,
I think the only thing he's had to eat since, like, last night is that piece of slime. So, like, he That's probably fair. Is pretty hungry.
And, he like, was I think he had, like, before he, they got D&D banished.
You'd have, like, a weapon bonus with, like, meat.
So it's like a video, it's like video games. Time he's done this. Like, it's like, you know, some video games where you, like, eat the food and you get more health or you become more empowered. I guess that's kind of what happened. Well, he didn't even eat it.
He got the stat bonus.
I don't know. But yeah, no, he's just a hungry boy, I guess.
Hudson also in this fight, like, literally just drop kicks one of the Vikings. I liked that too.
He does, yeah. I can't get enough of Hudson, honestly. Just like he's just, you know, he's the Papa Gargoyle. He's gotta
like defend. He's in his element right now. He's like in this his is element. What he is good at doing.
He's an old warrior and he's gonna do what a warrior does mm-hmm. best and drop kick the shit out of a Viking like a boss.
And like Tom sees the Gargoyles like saving them. He's like, I told you they'd save us.
Yes, I love that.
Because he is their number one fanboy.
And I like that little kids show element of like they don't actually like kill the Vikings. They just like scare them off. The Vikings are running off into like
yeah, they just all run away. But it's also funny because like the entire Viking army is apparently just like 10 guys now.
It's like I guess like the numbers decrease rapidly once the Gargoyles showed up.
Like I don't know what happened to everyone else, but they didn't show up to this fight.
They got obliterated by Broadway's like chicken meat club technique. Let's see, I have a few other notes about Broadway. Okay, yes. Last episode, regarding Broadway and his eating, we mentioned the offhand joke that there was probably art somewhere of Broadway voring Lexington.
Oh my god, please do not tell me that there is Broadway vore art.
So you want to hear something bafflingly crazy?
I don't know, do I?
You do. I could not find art of that, but what I did find was art of Lexington voring Brooklyn and Broadway.
Oh my god. I got up this morning very happy, not knowing any of these details. Like, what? Okay, so we do know that Lexington is into some kinky shit, though. So, like, if anyone did have a vore kink, I can see him having it.
Yeah, I guess.
Like, dreaming of just devouring his brothers and friends.
It's just, my expectations were defied. Like, I had better faith in the furry community, and I'm glad that, you know, someone was able to, you know, vent their kinkiness onto, you know, such a classic, yeah.
A classic scene. Speaking of the trio just in general, last episode, we weren't too sure, like, what their ages were supposed to be, and I felt like we were maybe a little, like, unsure about, like, calling them teenagers, but I looked it up on the Gargoyles wiki.
Oh, no.
And I have it here. So the trio, they all hatched in 958 AD, which makes them 36 years old at this point in time. But Gargoyles age half as fast as humans do, or they mature half as quickly. So at this point, biologically, like, if they were humans, they'd all be 18 years old.
Okay.
So I just want to throw that out there. We can now ogle them totally guilt free because
okay, good, good, good. I mean, I already knew in my head that it's like, or no, yeah,
they're... like I've always seen them as like young adults and not like, you know, like adolescent teens. But like this is just additional confirmation to that.
I also like that when you were
like,
saying
even
that...
as a kid, I always just saw them as like those cool like older kids who I would like.
Yes, exactly.
You know, like I would look up to that type of person.
I like how when you were explaining that, you didn't say that they age slower. You said they age half as quickly, and I was like thinking for a second, wait, do they age faster?
Yeah, it was awkwardly phrased. I'm doing my best here to explain
I like
gargoyle
that.
biology.
It was fine. It made me think. It made me think of things.
Good. I want the show to make people think.
I think we're doing a. I think we're doing a great job. Oh, God, I'm really nerding out this episode. You can
we're
tell.
We're not even like 5 minutes into this episode still.
Oh, well, listen, we have a lot to go off of here.
Oh my god, like so much happens.
So, the Magus comes out of the cave and sees the gargoyles, and he thinks, like, the princess is dead at this point, even though we haven't, like, seen a body. But I don't know. He's just, like, having a real diva.
This is, like,
he's having a
the
diva
number
moment.
One moment where I fucking hate the Magus. Because, yeah, like, he comes out. He sees the Viking army routed, and the gargoyles, like, celebrating, along with, like, the humans who they've just rescued. And instead of being happy about this, he's all like, you fools! She'd be alive now if you hadn't come! They would have ransomed us both! And meanwhile, like, he has... Why does he think she's dead? Last he saw her, she was running out, and people were chasing her. If I were him, I'd be like, oh, well, maybe I will follow and, like, save her and make sure she's okay. He just assumes she's dead. And it's all pissy about it. Like, this fucking guy.
He's
okay,
a
that
bitch.
Was my Magus rant. I'm okay
just,
now.
He's
I'm
having, like, a major
character.
Diva moment because he couldn't handle
he
being
is.
Tied up for 5 minutes. And he's never been in a hostage situation before, clearly. So he's
like,
just
he's
automatically
the worst.
Assuming, like, oh, the princess is dead, it's your fault! And then he pulls out his fucking book of spells. And he turns our fucking boys to stone forever because he's...
Right,
just,
like, he chants some bullshit in Latin and, like,
this
glowing, like... Oh, I'm so glad you wrote it down.
Yes!
This glowing mist, like, surrounds them and they all just turn to stone. Like, they would if the sun came up. As if the sun hasn't come up.
He doesn't actually say that. That was a Evil Dead reference.
Oh, but it sounded like what he does say.
No,
because
like in the Army of Darkness movie, they tell Bruce Campbell to chant some Latin phrase, and Bruce Campbell's like, "Don't tell it to me again. I remember it." And then he forgot it, and he had to like kind of cough the last word, and then it didn't work. But no, yeah, I love the Evil Dead series. Offhanded. So
I would rather have Bruce Campbell here right now than the Magus. I think he'd be much more helpful.
Oh, dude, Bruce Campbell would be just broing out with the gargoyles. He'd be flirting with them a little, because let's face it, Bruce Campbell will flirt with anyone.
Yeah, I think Hudson would take him to bed. That's just my gut instinct. That's
no,
where I'm
absolutely.
At.
But yeah, no, the Magus has a diva moment, blah, blah, blah. Our boys get turned into stone forever, and then... we cut to Goliath chasing the guard captain and Haken, and he finally catches up to them. Goliath intervenes and he sees Haken with the guard captain, and he is pissed. Like, he's just got the glowing eyes and everything, and he shouts.
I noticed that his pecs also got like really big in this scene. Like they're ballooning out with his own anger. It feels like.
Yes, very nice.
It's like they're bigger than they normally are.
He had momentarily tit expansion from his just angst and rage. Like, you know, because like when you're angry and you see like someone you trusted betray you, like you just you breathe super heavy and you're just
well, like the angler has to find a way to like make itself known somehow, and in Goliath's taste it just makes his chest bitter.
He has like an it's manly tit expansion, and then he's just pissed and he shouts, "So you are the betrayer!" at the guard captain, and the guard captain proceeds to be a fucking idiot, trying to reason with Goliath, saying, I wasn't supposed to be this way. I didn't turn
It
out.
was not supposed to be this way, in like his weird Scottish
And what he
accent.
says was, and Goliath is closing in on them, and the guard captain says, the worst thing to defend himself, oh, you should have taken the other gargoyles with you. And I'm just
Yeah,
like,
he's like victim blaming here.
bro, that's like, he's on the edge of a fucking cliff. And Hakon is like, you know,
Yeah,
he's.
did you notice, by the way, that the princess, as soon as she escapes, she runs straight to a fucking cliff? Like, where is she going? Because everyone is following her, you know?
Even think of that.
That's the first place she runs to, the edge of a fucking cliff.
Oh, she's
And
so
she's like right at the
stupid,
edge.
dude. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh
Like,
God.
I know she doesn't leave her throne room too often, probably, but like a little survival instinct, I would hope, is going to eventually kick in here.
She's like, I'm free, and she runs to the fucking cliff. I need a second. I need. Whew, fuck. Okay, so they're at the cliff, and you know, guard captain is trying to defend himself in this stupid way, and then Hakon, to save his own ass, points at the guard captain. And he's like, "He's the traitor. He's the one you want." And the guard captain's just like, "You lying scum!" Like super loud,
Lion scum.
and it's just
So, like,
like,
this angers me because, you know, this is their own burgeoning
he's not
relationship. And
really
look, it's ruined
lying, is the
now.
thing.
He is lying. He says that the guard captain shattered them, and the guard captain was against the shattering and
No,
tried
he
to
didn't say
stop
that the
it.
guard captain shattered him. He said that he's the one who betrayed you, which is true.
No, I think his exact line is he's the one you want, he shattered them.
No, I wrote it down.
I wrote it down too, and that's what I wrote.
He said
Oh my
he's
God, if
what?
break this tie, listeners, by emailing us with what you think Taton said. Do we even have an email address for this
We
show?
do. It's the loincloth hour at gmail.com.
Cool, I hope we get some emails.
I'm gonna have to check. I'm pretty sure it's just an empty inbox at the moment.
He's the one you want. He shattered them. You lying scum!
I was wrong. This angers the guard captain so much that, like, he just starts getting into a little tussle with him. And, you know, what is it that normally happens when you got four people on the edge of a cliff and two of them are tussling?
They just start wrestling.
Well, yeah.
Wrestling.
Yeah, you know. Well, I thought tussle was a funnier word to use.
Yeah, it is.
So what is it that usually happens when two guys are wrestling, fighting, tussling, or whatever on the edge of a cliff? Is that you lose their balance and
Oh,
they
right.
go over the cliff with the hostage,
Yeah, they just all fucking do. Like, everyone who doesn't have wings falls off this cliff.
and Goliath, of course, manages to catch a princess, and Hakon and the guard captain, like they just kind of they fall into darkness, and you know, we can only
Yes, like
presume.
very Roadrunner and Coyote-esque, like
Yes.
screaming down this cliff. And I'm sad to see them go.
I mean,
I know we will
same.
see them again eventually, but like, what a waste of dads.
Yeah, well, you know. Sometimes it just be like that.
We have plenty of backup dads coming though,
No,
so.
yeah. Like, I like Hakon too, but it's like, my love for another character outweighs that, so it's like, whatever.
It is sort of whatever. It's like, yeah, like they're just two gay dumbasses who were pretty evil, really. And like,
Yeah.
it's not even that the guy, Captain the Guard, was evil. He was just like a fucking moron.
They were both pretty stupid.
Hakon was probably
And to
evil.
this day, Hakon never learned how to read.
Yeah, he died before learning the wonders of literature.
He probably would have laughed at words anyway. He probably would have been the kind of guy to like take like the newspaper clippings and like jumble them around and say stupid stuff.
he would draw like mustaches on all the pictures.
he doesn't care
would,
about
he would draw like
no
he
pictures.
Would draw penises like in the margins of
yes
textbook.
He would draw penises. So they're dead. They're very
dead. And Goliath is really upset because he didn't even get to kill them. He says, like, I've been denied everything. Even my revenge!
It's such a fucking sad scene, honestly, because it's like, you know what happened to the other gargoyles, and Goliath is already pretty fucking, like, broken up about everything else that's happening. And
yeah, like, he loses everything in this episode.
He deserves so much better. Like, he just deserves... You know, he deserves a good and loving Dom to, you know, just give him all the needs a sub requires.
Yes, I agree.
And
thank him whenever he wants.
Yes, exactly. The big lavender gargoyle. Just butt. Anyway.
But then, like, right as this is happening, the little boy comes running
before
like,
that
unaccompanied
happens, before that happens the princess happen? Is about to like say some shit. You're like, do you think she's gonna apologize? She just says Goliath, I, and then she just stops because it's like there's no
you
way
know,
she can fucking apologize.
Honestly, like, good, just keep your mouth shut, lady. Like, you've done enough. Thank
like
you.
Like after years of bigotry and that has led to this, she's
yeah,
really
like, needs maybe
to just
pick
shut
your
her
moment out. Like, pick a less emotional time for him to open your mouth again.
Yeah, so anyways, Precious Tom runs up and he's just like, he's, you know, like, telling Goliath, like, Goliath, you have to help your friends! And...
Where is Tom's mom?
Who cares?
Like, am I the only one? I'm just like, why is this child running around unaccompanied?
He has, like...
Deadly Vikings, like, everywhere, probably.
He has, like, 6 adoptive gargoyle dads. Who cares about his mom?
Well, he does now.
Oh, he doesn't
so,
now.
Yeah, so the... Oh, that's right. Yes, because the view shifts, and it's Goliath seeing all of his friends and his dilf.
God,
all turned to stone.
It's just like, how can things get any worse? Oh, fuck.
Yeah, like most of your clan is dead. Oh, so don't worry. Now the rest of your clan is also dead.
Well,
like
not,
in
not,
case you
quote,
didn't
dead,
have enough tragedy
unquote.
Yet.
Because they're not really dead.
So he's all, like, just confused, because he's just, like, stone at night, like, what sorcery is this? And then Magus shows up, and he's all, like, sorcery indeed, and now you shall join them!
He's, like, all villainous, but then it's, like, he kind of sees, like, the princess, like, behind Goliath and stuff.
Yeah,
and
like,
then
the
next,
is, like,
the next
okay,
shot we
Goliath...
see is just him groveling on the ground, face. Looking at his ripped spellbook.
Yeah, like, he just sinks to his knees. Because, like, Goliath's pecs are, like, still so big that, like, the princess was standing behind Goliath and, like, nobody saw her.
This is just...
Then he does see her and he's just like, oh, shit, like, she's not dead. I turned these people to stone for no goddamn reason.
And Hakon happened to have burned the pages that had the counter spell.
Of course. Because, you know, it's not enough that the mages did this stupid shit. But now he also does this shit that he can't even fix.
Mm.
I hate the mages. Sins are compounding by the minute here.
Just, you know, me slapping a big old bitch stamp on his face right now.
I would.
Because he is a bitch.
Nice.
Of course, Goliath rightfully picks this fucking nerd shit up, and he's just like, reverse the spell, bring them back now, yelling at this little twat. And the Magus...
He sort of picks him up like he picked up a kitten, like,
oh, yeah,
behind
does.
The neck.
He does. He's, like, yelling at the Magus to do it, but the counterspell has been burned, and Goliath just promptly drops this dude, and we get this shot of just him landing on his ass, and his ass is hitting the book. And
yeah, like,
I think
his
that,
ass onto
that
the
just,
book.
That speaks for itself right there.
He face-sits the book, thanks to Goliath.
Okay. I don't know why that made me laugh.
I don't know what I'm saying at this point.
I love it though. So the princess is just asking, like, are they stoned forever? And the Magus is just like, the spell's terms say they can only be unstoned until the castle I'm wording this beautifully.
Unstoned.
The Magus is just like, until the terms of the spell, they can only be stone until the castle rises above the clouds. What? And
They
I'm just
would
like
sleep
thinking, what
until
the
the castle rises above the clouds, which is a weird term to put on your spell, I feel like.
I don't know if he made this spell. Like, did he? Like, do they make
I have no
spells?
idea. Like, it was did was it just in the book like that, or did he dictate the terms when he cast it?
Dude, I don't know. Magic people are just, they're so,
I don't know. But like, I feel like it's like a metaphorical thing. Like, that when the castle rises above the clouds, like that could mean a number of different things. But in this show, like most spells, as we find out, it's just completely literal.
Yeah, we do. It is. So, you know, like, they bring the gargoyle statues, the now stoned boys, our boys who are now stoned, are just set up on their pedestals back at the castle. I guess.
Yeah, like, they're all put into, like, their favorite places that I guess they had when they were alive. Like,
yeah.
They like to perch there, I'm assuming.
And, Goliath is, mentioning that they're, oh, well, they're trying to apologize first, but it's like,
okay, yeah, I actually laughed at this part a lot, because Magus is being, like, really apologetic right now. Like, he does feel bad about what he did.
Yeah.
And he's like, I wish there was something I could do. But Goliath straight up just ignores him, like, completely.
Yeah.
And, like, he only talks to the princess. He's like, what will you do now, princess? Like, he is not talking to that asshole right there.
Yeah, so the princess, I forget what she says. I think they're just gonna, like, go to, like, a, it's not safe for them there.
Yeah, she says they're gonna go to her uncle. She'll gather up the people who are left and just, like, go to her uncle's castle.
And, Goliath also tells them to take care of, like, the eggs that are in the rookery and are gonna hatch in, like, 50 or so years.
Uh-huh.
I don't know.
Yeah, and if I could pick the two worst people on the planet to take care of a bunch of gargoyle eggs, I'd probably pick these two assholes.
It's just like, oh, that's really nice that the fate of the gargoyle species are in the hands of two recently reformed races.
Uh-huh. Yeah, but no, but she acts like that's totally, like, a cool thing. She's like, never fear, we'll watch over them as if they were our own. Like, bitch, 24 hours ago, you would have smashed all these eggs. Like, let's be real right now.
Yeah, honestly, it's so petty. Then, you know, after that's all said and done, Goliath requests from the Magus that he uses his spell one more time. And that, well, when I first heard that, I was super, like, you know, depressed about that. I'm just like, oh my god, that's the saddest shit I ever heard. But then it's like, the Magus just gives this really weird, just reactory expression. And I have to dissect this. He kind of looks like a duck, but it's hard to put into words. Like, he has his mouth open like an idiot, and, you know, he's just constantly...
I do not recall his expression, probably because I was so
I think it's like the last
the
photo I sent you,
scene.
Or one of the last ones. Like, I don't know. I just think his face is
well,
weird.
He's probably astounded that Goliath is just, like, talking to him again, but only asking for, like, him to assist him in a suicide move.
Mm.
So I guess that's the face you make when somebody asks something like that.
I guess. but no, he gets... Then we don't see it happen, though. We just kind of fade out, and then we see Goliath in his thinker pose at the top of the castle. Now a stone. And then we get this nice horizon shot of him, you know, as a stone statue standing beside the moonlight, which, you know, would be good for, like, a credit roll still, hint, hint.
Yeah, I feel like that should be the end of the episode, but we're only halfway through this fucking episode.
No, yeah, there's a lot more that happens.
Like, my memory was that the first two episodes were, like, the Viking stuff in the past, and the next three was all the modern day stuff, but I was wrong.
We're essentially dissecting
this episode,
like,
is like split
into,
like,
50-50
parts.
Yeah, so with that all said and done in the past, we finally cut back to the present day, where in the daytime, we get this, you know, nice whimsical music as we see the castle ruins covered in moss.
Yeah, it's like it's letting us know, like, okay, kids, like, sad stuff happened, but now put on your happy faces again, because this clown man is here to to brighten your day.
Yes! We're introduced to Croop's favorite character.
Okay, he's not my favorite.
He's not
he's
your
one
favorite,
of my
I know, but...
He is... He, you know what? He probably is close to being my favorite.
Yeah, he just...
I
oh
love
my
him.
God.
But okay, so we see the castle again, but like now it's all moss-covered. So we get the impression like a lot of time has passed. We don't get like a caption, like when we went back to 994 AD, but
yeah.
You just sort of get the impression that time has passed, you know.
Yeah.
Context clues. And we see the back of this man in a ponytail and wearing a trench coat.
Black gloves.
And with the inestimable voice of Jonathan Frakes, my favorite, he says, "At last, Castle Wyvern." And then we see all the gargoyles, like just, you know, their statue forms all covered in ivy.
So immediately the next thing we see is this dude just parkouring over the castle ruins just to be excellent.
He is having such a good time. Like, he reminds me of
he's
a little
so,
kid there.
He does. He's like this excited little kid running, like, to see his Christmas presents.
He's all just, like, clambering over, like, stones and stuff. Like he's acting exactly like I would be if I got to investigate a ruined castle. He's
I mean,
all smiling.
Honestly. And he's like running up the stairs. You know, he's just like he's just like a very sure of himself, you know, excited person. And then he walks up to specifically the Goliath statue.
Yeah, because he's gay.
Okay.
He goes straight to Goliath, like every other gay character in this show. They go straight for Goliath.
All right, there's a lot. There's a lot that happens with this episode. But first, we're going to start it all here, where he's just kind of rubbing the moss off of Goliath's face.
Yeah, he's rubbing this... Goliath's face, and he says, "Magnificent."
Yeah! It's so good. It's just, there's no context for anything yet.
Yeah, like, we have no idea who this person is or, like, what is going on, but all we know is that he thinks that statue Goliath is, like, super hot.
And then
he's very into him.
Right after that, we're introduced to Croop's second favorite character.
Oh my god!
I think you actually made the offer now,
Owen. This instant, and then we see a blonde man in glasses enter, who is like Xanatos' mervant.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best word I can pick to explain
this character.
What
this ponytail clad running. Character is named Xanatos, by the way.
Yeah, I guess we should have mentioned that at some point.
Well, no, his name doesn't get mentioned until right here.
Oh, yes, because he's all like, "Yes, Mr. Xanatos," or whatever the hell
he says. Oh, I wrote down what he says, because Owen did use these big words that pissed me off.
Because Owen is iconic, okay?
He's just this astute butler character. He's just like, "May I remind you, Mr. Xanatos, that the cost of this venture will be astronomical." And I just want to beat the shit out of this guy just for...
Hey, he is doing his job here. Okay, Owen is very... like, his one personality trait is that he is very devoted to his work. And his work is just serving Xanatos. Whether
That's
that means,
true.
Like, making phone calls... giving him erotic massages,
mm-hmm.
being his personal bodyguard, like going down
does,
on him,
is,
like
there,
he does
there
whatever.
There is a massage scene, isn't there?
Is there?
There probably is. I feel like there is.
I feel like there is too, but like I don't know at this point if there
it's
really
like that
is
scene
or if you just imagine
from
that
like
there
the
is.
Lex the Superman animated series, where just when we first are introduced to Superman meeting Lex Luthor, Lex Luthor is just straight up naked getting a massage.
Nice. That's the way you meet your like heroic arch rival, really.
Yes.
I feel like Xanatos like wanted to do that with Goliath.
Yes.
But he just didn't have the time
no,
to set
like,
it up.
Like,
we're getting ahead of our
what he should have done was he should have put the gargoyles in just like his in his like spa chambers or something. And
yes.
He's just wearing nothing but a robe when like Goliath wakes up, but
yeah, and then he opens the robe, so like the first thing Goliath sees.
He's here we go with the flashing.
He would
again.
Imprint on it like a duck.
Oh my god. So
okay, anyway, so Owen, he also says it would be difficult to find workers for whatever the hell Xanatos even wants to do with this castle, because the castle's considered haunted. And then Xanatos says the fantastic line, you know the answer to that, Owen. pay a man enough, and he'll walk barefoot into hell.
God, there's a post.
Which, again,
there's a post going around that talks about that line specifically, and they were like, "I thought this was like something out of like Hamlet or Shakespeare, but no, it's freaking Gargoyles."
No, he's not quoting anything. Like, he's just quoting himself.
Yes, it's such a good line, though.
Like, it feels like to get past the censors, like, it would almost have to be, like, some sort of classical quote, but it isn't. And just, like, the blood that we saw last episode, I think the show is just, like, really pushing the bounds of what the censors would allow.
Well, that's why Gargoyles, that's a big part of why Gargoyles is so iconic, because it's, like, it's not like it was trying to push boundaries for the sake of pushing boundaries. It was trying to tell a story, and the story just so happened to push boundaries.
Yeah, it's just telling, like, a mature story. Like, it's for kids, but, like, it's not talking down to kids. And it's like, hey, you know, there's some serious topics going on here.
Yes, exactly.
I think they probably get around it because the way Xanatos is referring to it, like, it's definitely, like, he's referring to hell as a place. Mm-hmm. He's not just saying hell, like, just for the hell of it, like, to curse.
Yeah.
But, like, you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, I know. I get what you're saying. You know, it's like that when you're a kid. Whenever you hear, like, a swear word, like, you know, even something as minimal as hell on TV, you're just like, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that was my reaction as a child. I was like, whoa, like, I wasn't expecting him to say that. God. But then I was like, that's so cool. He got to say hell on TV.
I think, like, for me, when I first got into Gargoyles, I was already, like, a swearing beast in middle school or whatever. So it just kind of passed through my ears like nothing when I first heard it.
So right after that, well, we see the construction crew that he presumably hired, and like they're using those exosuits from like the Alien movie.
Yeah, I
what is up with that? Like, I guess that's just to like make it clear that even though this episode is now taking place in modern day, or at least, you know, 1994 modern day,
right,
I guess they're just sort of showing us that like the technology is slightly ahead of where we were at in the 90s,
because
I'm pretty sure that those exosuits are not from real life.
No, they're not. It's because there's literally laser rifles later in the episode. Xanatos is just that extra with his like richness.
He is, yeah. So like I don't know where the exosuits come from.
He's like a much more likable Elon Musk.
Oh my god, please don't compare those two.
I'm sorry!
He's like Elon Musk if he was actually competent and only wanted to use his vast wealth to, like, fuck around. It's pretty much there.
I mean, Elon Musk does fuck around. It's
That's what Elon Musk does. You know, we're getting unnecessarily political.
This is a political podcast, it's fine. Unnecessarily political. You were literally talking last episode about like how the Gargoyles were a socialist commune or something.
Okay, just they are though.
Okay,
they are.
Fine, fair enough. So the only notes I really took on like when we were seeing like the castle being like all cleaned up and stuff was like, man, I wish I had this team for allergy season because they're very good at dusting.
That would be fantastic. But yeah, they clean the castle, then they start like taking it apart, like including the gargoyle statues, and they sort of like put everything in crates, and then
they put Goliath in a big old padded crate
and start just going across the ocean. Like, is this how you would transport a castle,
dude? I don't know. No one just simply transports a castle from like old Scotland ruins to like modern day New York and have it like be discreet or anything. I refuse.
Like,
to
I feel like we're already stretching the boundaries of like realism, but I don't. I would assume you'd put them like on a boat, maybe, and like the boat would sail across the ocean.
I don't know. Xanatos is just that extra. He literally transported a whole freaking castle and a bunch of gargoyles just so because he's mad about seeing if that gargoyle dick is real or not. That's
like this is all that he wants. He just wants Goliath's dick. He hasn't even met Goliath yet.
He's literally just like feeling up the statue already and stuff already.
Feeling the butt, feeling every part of Goliath. Mm-hmm. Like when Goliath does emerge, we're spoiling ourselves. But, like, he's gonna feel used, like, oh, someone's been touching me, like, every part of me.
He should be used to that by now.
And, you know, the Captain of the Dart was doing that before Xanatos was around.
Yeah.
But, okay, so anyway, so, basically, Xanatos dismantles the castle in Scotland, mm-hmm. and then rebuilds the castle on top of a skyscraper, which he owns.
Yeah.
We see the New York City skyline all of a sudden, including the World Trade Center, which I've got used to seeing now, like every time they show New York City, because it is shown fairly often.
I'm not
often
that observant. I don't know. I just seen like New York. I'm just like, ooh, look at the pretty lights.
Well, I noticed that like pretty much every time, just because it was sort of like ingrained on my own psyche at the time. And we see Xanatos like riding in a red helicopter, which has his own name on it, up to where the castle is now on top of a building. I don't know if that would work in real life, but I don't care.
I don't. Either, let's not question
it's
it.
Fucking awesome. This is where I want to live.
It
I
does
want
look
to live
awesome.
In a castle. That's on top of a building. Yeah. That's all I actually want in life.
Yeah. So we see now that we are above like the clouds, like we're in the skyline with the castle.
The castle has risen above the clouds.
Yes. And and then like the sun sets over the horizon, and like Xanatos is just standing next to the Goliath statue.
Just staring at Goliath's ass, like waiting for him to come to life.
Yes.
And then spoiler, he does come to life. Like thunder and lightning starts. It's sort of like the birth of Frankenstein.
Okay. You can't just say he does come to life. There's like a whole like cinematic sequence around.
I'm
this
getting
scene.
There. Yeah, like cracks in the stone form, and then they just like explode off of Goliath, which they don't normally. Yes, I'm not sure why they do it this time.
Because
other than that,
like
there's like
the
a magical.
It's the first
time
they woke up in like 1,000 years.
Yeah, so like it's a heavy wake up call for them. And then Xanatos like 100% has the sexual awakening as he's watching Goliath like flex off all his stone and just roar for no apparent reason, like up into the stormy skies.
So yeah,
Xanatos
there's like
is,
this.
Like, gasping
there's this
and,
long like
behind him as he's watching.
There's this like long drawn out sequence where it's like we're anticipating them awakening. Like you know, you're just like all hyped up. Like oh man, we get to see them awaken, and then we just like see like the cracks of lavender glow come out as the stone is coming apart, and then Goliath just awakens and he's just like stretching and flexing his muscles and everything, and we see from below like they're also all the other gargoyles are awakening as well, and the music is just
triumphant. Yeah, they're awake too.
Yes. The music is just so triumphant.
Yeah, the music was really nice in that part, because like it was so happy. After the fucking downer we had like not even 5 minutes ago.
Oh my god.
I feel like that's another way that they were able to get this episode across. Like it is really depressing, but then like it's almost immediately undone. Like all the characters you like are still okay. Like they're all alive still.
And now Goliath is just like, we're awake, we're alive, and then there's this really wholesome sequence I like where they're all just like together hugging in the rain. I'm just like, oh my god, I love my wholesome gargoyle family.
Family. Lexington immediately goes bronze, like gives him a big hug, which is very introvert energy, like going for the dog right away.
And then Lexington makes this like, I put this in my notes, he makes like a weird Mickey Mouse sounding noise, like oh, and he looks over he looks over to like the edge of the building or the castle, and he sees like they all see like the city, and they get this huge sense of culture shock.
They've never seen anything like even remotely like that before.
Exactly. Just all the
and,
lights.
Like, do they say something there? I feel like that would be a perfect time for like the line, like it doesn't look like we're in Kansas anymore.
They do say something.
No, that probably wouldn't make any sense.
Hudson is like, you know, he's like, what is this? Where are we? So they're just kind of in shock and awe of the city buildings and the lights from below, and it's like you know, these beast men from the medieval times suddenly in a modern civilization. And then Xanatos fades in from behind them in this very funny transparent crossfade where he's just kind of invisible for a split second. I took a screenshot of it for myself for the memes.
Like an evil sorcerer. And he's like, you're the one called Goliath. And Goliath is like, yes. And Xanatos says, excellent. Follow me to my bedroom.
I put in my notes that he's just like this giddy child on Christmas when he says this. And he's just like orgasming so much on the inside. He's just like, yes, these things are actually real. And he's just, I'm sure a big part of it is just happy because his millions didn't go to waste. Because he probably spent like a fortune.
I am positive you are correct.
He spent like a fortune getting that castle in the sky.
Xanatos is a furry, correct? Yeah. Like, in modern day terms, we would just call him a furry. So, like, imagine being a furry, which you and I can both imagine pretty easily, and then furry. Discovering a way to, like, make, like, buff, manly furries, like, the real thing in real life. So, like, we can see why Xanatos is, like, super into this.
Yeah, exactly.
He's a pervert.
Yeah.
That's, like, a furry pervert, a fervor. So they retire to, like, his conference room, or the entrance hall. I don't know where the hell they are. They're in a beta room.
They're in the castle, or whatever.
Xanatos tells them some completely bullshit story, because they ask, like, how long it's been, and he tells them it's been 1,000 years. And then he says he learned of the castle from, quote, an ancient book that recently came into my possession.
That was the Magus'
like,
spellbook,
wasn't
it?
Fell on you, wrote it all down. And then he says, now, I'm sure you have questions. Like, that's all he gives them. Now he's like, now I open the floor up to you to say whatever you want.
They also ask about the rookery
but yeah,
eggs.
Like, so...
And Xanatos says that they're gone, but it's like...
Yeah, he just says they're gone.
He doesn't really know
like,
that,
he doesn't
though.
Fucking know.
Like, how would
he doesn't,
know that?
Well, the whole thing with Xanatos is he is manipulating them from, like, the get-go. So, by telling them that they're the last of their kind, that makes them more dependent, like, on him.
That's,
and, like,
that
they
is
don't,
good. That is true.
It keeps them from getting, like, sidetracked onto, as Xanatos would see it, like, other topic. Like, he doesn't want them to care about eggs or, like, finding other gargoyles. He just wants them here in his castle. Being hot and serving as eye candy for him to look at.
They're just like these loincloth clad servants for him.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So he explains that like he solved the curse by making the castle rise above the clouds, and like Goliath is just sort of like, why? Like, okay. Like even he is like, well, this makes no fucking sense. Like,
yeah, no, Goliath is like, what the fuck? But then, there's something I put here that Xanatos for a second has these very, like, shiny puppy-like eyes when he's talking to Goliath. Like, he's trying to get this whole demeanor of wholesomeness that we're supposed to, quote, buy into, you know? And then...
Yeah, like, the animation is, like, oddly, like, very smooth for this conversation.
Yes.
Just Xanatos, like, leaning against a desk, basically, and, like, talking. Like, that's all that's really happening here.
And he's just like, I wanted to see the legends is true. And then he walks up to Goliath and puts his hand on his shoulder, and he's like, now that
oh
I know it's true, that I want to be your
I
friend.
I want to be your friend. Yeah, your friend with benefits. Wink, wink. And then, no, he also says... There is much we can do for each other, Goliath.
Yes, yes, yes. And Goliath is, like, even, like, he's given this look to the hand on his shoulder, like, he
yeah, like, he knows...
knows
exactly what that hand means. He's
he
like,
knows...
well, hold
he,
on
he
there,
fucking,
champ.
Like, he's just, he knows Xanatos is an individual who doesn't keep his hands to himself. He never learned that.
Yeah, he's a little handsy. But then Goliath asks, such as, like, in reply to, Xanatos saying that there's much we can do for each other. And before Xanatos can answer, they suddenly all hear a helicopter noise. And Xanatos is like, I wasn't expecting anyone, and he heads out. So my question right now for you is, we know because we've watched the show into the future that this encounter that's coming up is all actually been pre-planned by Xanatos. So do you think that he has planned it out, like, down to the second that he is asked, like, a question that's even remotely awkward, that he doesn't want to answer, that the helicopters show up? Do you think he planned it out, like, that well?
I can't say for sure, but if he didn't, he got very lucky.
Like, I feel like he did.
Because, like, I mean, I feel like he could. He did, yes. And if not, then it's just sheer luck that that happened. So, he tells... the gargoyles to stay there while he checks it out, and the gargoyles,
they almost immediately just follow him.
They exchange some looks. They're like, really? And then they're like, no, they just follow him, and he knows they're following him.
And then so we go outside and we see there's like this big like hovering helicopter up above them, And out of it comes the squad of what I can only describe them as 90s Image Comics characters.
Like, I describe them as just like SWAT guys or SWAT people or something, because they look like...
Right, but they're also wearing, like spandex, like superhero-y sort of looking
outfits. They are, yes. No.
Like, they look like Image Comics to me, which I don't know if you were around in the 90s for that, but I sure was.
I was not, but I am aware of what Image Comics is. Thank you.
You're welcome. So there's five of them, and I sort of like that, like, even though they're only, like, mooks, basically, and they don't, like, even have names, but they all do have distinctive personalities and, like, body types.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like extra effort went into animating these characters for some reason.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, like, I can tell all of them apart just by looking at them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a woman with them, too. There's, like, a blonde lady with a ponytail, which is, you know, it's very neoliberal of me to say how cool that is, but I don't know, it's nice to say that there's a woman with the assassination.
I don't think it's anything to just say, oh, I'm glad there's a woman in the mix.
It's neat. There's a lady there.
Yes.
There is. Okay, this fight scene goes on for a while, but the gargoyles charge in, and then, like, sort of one of my favorite things about this show is how it mixes genres. Like, up until now, we were in, like, a very medieval, like, fantasy sort of show. And now, all of a sudden, the gargoyles are fighting, like, a SWAT team with, like, guns and grenades and shit. So I just think that's, like, neat just visually to watch.
It's like a little sci-fi and fantasy blend.
Yes. So pretty much immediately, we see that these guys are, like, a lot better trained than the Vikings were. Because Goliath is, like, a cool tail lash move, like he did to the Vikings, but then the guy just, like, rolls back to his feet immediately.
Goliath immediately, and then he goes in on all fours. You know, Brooklyn's like, what's going on? Hudson's just like, they're attacking the castle, that's all we need to know. And of course, Goliath is the first to, like, charge in, you know, because he's, like, he's already made this new, like, quote, friend or whatever, or something.
Mm-hmm.
They immediately...
His new fuck buddy.
His new fuck buddy, yeah. They immediately resort to just defending the castle, and Goliath immediately...
Right, yeah. Because, you know, like, as Hudson says, like, a large part of the gargoyle culture is defending the castle, and, like, this castle is all they have right now. It's, they've only just woken up in this time, so seeing it threatened is, like, the one thing that will make them, like, go into a fight right away.
Yeah, but, yeah,
which Xanatos probably knows about, and it's
Goliath is, like, being shot at, but he's just, like, running on all fours, and while he's doing this, we do get to see really close angles of his loincloth, you know?
Oh my god, I didn't even notice that. I was so into the action.
Dude.
That's true. That's a lie.
That's not true. I know for a fact it's not true.
So Goliath does the tail lash, the guy rolls back to his feet, and then he immediately, like, tackles Goliath back, and Goliath gets knocked off his feet.
And then,
which makes me very
Xanatos
impressed. This
comes
just
in,
like, a normal guy. Yes, and Xanatos goes in, and he's a fucking, like, judo chop.
It's like such a light little movement, but there's, like, this aggressive karate chop noise that comes with it.
Xanatos is amazing, and, like, everything he does is so extra. Like, of course, he can't just punch somebody. He has to be, like, a master of, like, Chinese martial arts.
Right.
So yeah, like, he knocks the gun out, and then he, like, flips the guy over his shoulder, which was amazing.
That was pretty cool.
So Xanatos just saved Goliath, but then another guy, like, goes to Xanatos, but then Xanatos is saved by Broadway, who swoops in, and the guy is like, nice mask.
I noticed that,
which is like, ha ha ha, yeah, because, you know, gargoyles aren't real. The guy, like, pulls a knife on Broadway, and then Broadway, like, falls back. And here's the part that I screen capped.
Yes.
Throws him, like,
Broadway
over
puts
himself.
His back to the ground, legs in the air, while this guy's running at him, and he, like, flips him. And while he's doing this, we do see little skimmits of his blue ass as he's doing this. And it's very,
like, we
subtle.
Literally completely see his ass. Like, it's just out there.
It is out there. You have to, like, pause, but you were just flashed. You know it was there.
Like, I don't know if the animators, like, should have made the loincloths a little bit longer or what, but, like, they're into it now. They've already,
like,
drawn the character designs. They can't go back.
Later in the series, they do, like, kind of They do fall under this mistake a lot where they accidentally show us, like, full-on just male ass. And there are times where, whenever we do see up the loincloths, that we just, they animate, like, some underwear or something underneath them, which doesn't
make
any sense.
Yeah, but, you know, that's not part of my own personal canon. The gargoyles do not wear underwear.
No, they are not.
I'm telling you right now.
We are not called the Underwear Hour.
No, we're not. It would be like if somebody, like, drew Venom. Like Eddie Brock as wearing underwear underneath his symbiote, which we know he doesn't.
No.
He's completely naked under that.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so let's see. Like, this fight goes on for a long time.
Yeah. Not only does it go on for a while, we cut back and forth to other scenes while it's going on.
Yeah, and there's 10 characters involved. There's 11. No, there's 12. I can't. So I forgot about Xanatos, and then I forgot about Bronx. Bronx is here too.
Oh my God.
Okay, so Hudson, like, is fighting someone with his sword, which is really cool, but then, like, he gets tasered. This is to, like, the same guy, by the way, who, like, got flipped over by Broadway after, like, attacking Xanatos. Like, this one guy sort of knocking the whole team out on their ass. But, so every other gargoyle, like, comes in, like, and they all, like, collectively hold Hudson to make sure he's okay. Like, it's actually really cute.
It is. But then
a grenade gets thrown at them.
And Lexington catches it, and he just kind of doesn't know what the fuck it is. He's just like, and he throws it over his shoulder like it's nothing.
Where it then explodes.
And then it explodes and staggers them.
I'm confused, because we know that this attack is set up by Xanatos just like to test the gargoyles and to like to see how they'll react in a situation like this. But like, I'm pretty sure he doesn't want them all killed, right? So why are his goons like throwing loaded grenades at them that can explode and kill them? Because what if Lex didn't toss that grenade? They'd all be dead right now.
Listen, I don't.
I'm thinking too much.
I don't
about
know.
Like,
Xanatos is a complex man.
He is so complex. Because the next thing Xanatos does is he runs and goes to his secret laser gun panel.
Right!
Which he has.
It's just,
in
no,
his castle.
He presses a random brick in the castle and then he just gets a secret gun panel.
And he just starts, like, shooting, like, everywhere. And, like, of course, they can't show, like, him actually lasering people because it's still a kid's show.
And
so, like, mostly
that,
he just shoots his
up.
Own castle.
Yeah, no, he shoots around them, and rubble falls onto, like, the SWAT guys or whatever.
Yeah, like, it's okay to bury people in rubble, but it's not okay to actually, like, shoot them and actually injure them.
Yeah. God, a lot happens in this fight.
So, Lexington, like, goes for the female squad member, because he's gay, and then he has to choose a Viking,
no,
but she
he,
just, like,
he,
starts
he,
shooting at him.
He's got, like,
these
glowing eyes and this menacing glare, and he asks in just, like, this innocent, you know, just, like, sort of childish tone, are you a Viking?
Are you a Viking? Yeah, it was actually really cute.
It was, yeah, but then she just immediately responds by, like, trying to, like, shoot him.
Mm-hmm. Hudson says something like, oh, these weapons, we must be battling sorcerers. And then we just see Xanatos, like, shooting more of his own fucking castle, because he is also fighting with some guy, and then we see the scene at the beginning of the first episode again. We see all the rubble falling down onto the New York street, like, below, and people, like, screaming and running. So we now know that, like, okay, we're back to where we started, like, that earlier scene was connected to this one.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, everything's good now. The watchers are The gears are spinning in their heads as to what's happening.
Yeah, the civilians on looking in the sidewalk as the rubble falls, like, around them and stuff, and they all act like a bunch of fucking idiots, and then Elisa shows up and she says her iconic line again, where it's like, get back or you'll wind up street pizza.
Yeah, like, I like that they play that again for us,
because
it wasn't good enough.
They were really
time.
Proud of that line.
They probably were. Elias gets, like, knocked off the building.
He does.
And, like, he falls for quite a ways down. Like, he grabs onto a flagpole at one point, but, like, he's too heavy for it, so it just snaps off.
When I was watching this, I was thinking, why doesn't he just fly? But then I remember what you said last time
they
we recorded.
Can't fly.
They can't
they can
fly, they can only glide.
Which I think this five-parter is, like, the only time in the history of the show that they will actually, like, abide by that rule. Because after this, they definitely break that all the time.
Yeah.
But like he sort of stops his fall by digging his nails into the building, and like that slows him down. He looks like a giant cat,
He does look
basically.
like a giant cat.
And it's
He's
like this horrible like chalkboard noise as
one
he
of
does
my
this.
kind, you know.
Yes.
He's descended from cats.
Lexington gets pinned by some
guy.
Yes,
I wrote that down.
And he just sort of like squirms around under him.
And the guy's just like, gotcha.
Yeah, I like to this part had like big like bottom brat energy to me.
He had like big
just, like,
gay
squirming
panic.
And being like, oh, stop. Oh, this is hot. Stop it. I'm getting a boner. Like that was the impression I got from this.
No, Lexington absolutely.
Which, you know, like good for Lex getting his thrills where he can.
Yes.
But then, like, he's rescued by, like, Goliath has another, like, big daddy moment, because he climbs back up by then,
mm-hmm.
and then he swoops in, like, tackles the guy off of Lexington. He's like, only I get to make Lexington feel that way.
Exactly.
That's pretty much how it comes across.
Yes.
But then, like, a fucking gas canister comes.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
Like, that takes Goliath down. Like, the gargoyles are just getting their asses handed them this entire fight, so which actually sort of makes me upset, because these aren't even... Like, these aren't even real bad guys. This is just a team of, like, random people.
Granted, like, the only time they're getting their asses kicked with this fight is because they literally just woke up and they're, like, they have no idea.
Right, they're just woke up. They're totally disoriented. Yeah. And they're dealing with, like, stuff that they have no experience with. Like, they don't know what a gun is or what any of these things that are being thrown at them are.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, yeah, you can see why they're just sort of, like, you know, like, why this is happening.
So, the bad guys, I guess, get this, like, briefcase while this is happening, and...
Yeah, like, one of them goes in and gets that, and then they shoot up, like, a flare gun, because I guess they got what they came for, whatever this briefcase is, and the helicopter comes along, and, like, they all sort of pile back into it.
And then Xanatos, I guess, like, is, like, about to shoot them down, but then the guy, I forget what he throws at Xanatos. Is
okay,
he, like,
Xanatos is, like, I don't think so. Well, like, pointing his, like, badass laser rifle at the helicopter, and the squad guy is like he's a fucking ninja, and he throws a shuriken at Xanatos, and it hits his gun. It's like he's from an episode of Naruto all of a sudden.
I was wondering, like, what the fuck he threw at him. I was like, was that a rock? And I was too lazy and invested in my notes to, like, go back and check.
No, it's literally and this is a great example of how extra the entire rest of this show will be. Just in terms of, like, banana things, like, just happening. Like, does Xanatos hire this guy specifically to throw a shuriken at him as they're getting away? Like, I don't know. It was amazing, though.
Yeah, he literally paid these guys, I want you to make me look super cool, because...
Yes, just make me look awesome. Be as extra as possible. It'll be a great time.
Yeah, because he wants to impress Goliath.
Of course. But anyway, so the guys, they all get away, though. They get into the helicopter leaves. So afterwards, they're all just sort of, like, picking themselves back up.
And Hudson thinks, like, they have, like, a dragon transporting them, because they don't know what
they're sort of going over, like, what even, like, was that that stuff that they had, and Hudson is like, it must have been a dragon, but Lexington says, no, it was some sort of machine,
and that's
which telegraphs what his arc will be for a while, like, becoming the tech guy.
Yeah, I love that he's the tech guy. I resonate with Lexington so much. And when he pointed that out, I'm just like, yes, he's a fellow techie.
Like, I feel like as a kid watching the show, that was also probably the moment where, like, I identified with Lexington, because, like, he was the smart one and he was, like, the littler guy.
Yes.
And I don't know, like, I've always liked Lexington, like, so much.
Oh, yeah, man.
And that was probably, like, the first moment I was really just like, oh, Lexington is so cool and he's like me.
Xanatos tries to thank them for their efforts, but then Goliath just offhandedly mentions he has trust issues because of the guard captain. And then Xanatos says...
When Xanatos thanks him, he says pretty much, like, the exact words that the captain of the guard had used before, like, that the last time the gargoyles repelled an invasion.
Right, yeah, exactly. And Xanatos legit just says, I see I'll have to work to earn your trust, you know, because, you know, he's just like, yeah, I've come this far trying to get a gargoyle boyfriend. I'm not giving up now. And then...
And Goliath just sort of, like, growls at that, but, like, it's an oddly hot growl. He's like, yes, you will.
Oh, my God. I didn't notice that.
He's like, try to earn my trust if you can. I don't let my barriers down for just anybody, big
You
boy.
have to
Like, that was the
be
impression I got from Goliath.
a level 4 boyfriend to know my tragic backstory.
Exactly. But, like, he just got out of a bad relationship with the last human who had, like, an insane crush on him.
Yeah.
He's not ready to do it again just yet. Give it another episode.
So Goliath rightfully asks him, why were you attacked? And Xanatos just pompously says, the richer you are, the more enemies you have, and I'm very rich. And
it's like the most pompous thing you can say. That is an Elon Musk line.
All I wrote down after that was Xanatos equals sugar daddy, and I don't know what I meant. I think I do know.
Oh my god. No, because he's mentioning how rich he is.
Yes.
Like, specifically so that they know. And he's just like, I can treat you to anything you want, guys.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God.
Dude, he's so gay. And then,
But the gayest part isn't even happened yet.
No, yeah, we're about to get into that. Xanatos offers them refuge at the castle. And it's funny how they act like for a moment they have a choice in the matter. Because Hudson literally just puts his claw on Goliath's shoulder. Is like, it's your choice, lad, but we've nowhere else to go. And it's just like...
Yeah, like everyone's touching Goliath at this moment. But yeah, it is funny because Hudson is like, it's up to you. But also, like, this is the only thing you can fucking do. And if you pick something else, then you're a bad leader. Is basically what Hudson's saying here.
Yeah, I mean, he's not wrong. But I mean, of course, they stay. And Xanatos, being the giddy gay boy he is, he's excited to hear that.
Okay, his exact line is here, excellent. I know you've been used poorly by men in the past, but all that is about to change. While he's taking Goliath's hand and, like, squeezing it, is it even subtext here?
I audibly saw that scene, and I shouted, what? Because I don't remember it being this gay from memory.
Like, we remember that, like... there was gay subtext, but that, like, it was gayer than both of us remembered it being.
God, okay. No, it's like he just, he's, the whole line of just, like, I know you've been used poorly by men in the past, and it's
yeah,
just
like, not by
that...
humans, but, like, by men,
and
is what
I,
makes
and
it, like, okay,
I
that's
say...
odd phrasing there, Xanatos.
And it's like, you can't make that sound gayer if you tried. Oh, but they do! They do.
But yeah, because just Goliath then is like, yes, you saved us from the curse, but we won't be trusting humans ever again. And Xanatos says, I can tell this relationship is something we'll all have to work at.
Like, bruh, just propose already at this point.
No, he is moving too fast. Goliath has already told him he's not ready for a relationship yet, but Xanatos is just like, nope, this is a relationship now, we're dating. You're my man toy. Meet my other man toy, Owen. Now I have two of you.
That's all
Xanatos
is
just
to
so
do.
Used to just getting what he wants.
Yeah, he's just getting... He wants a bunch of man toys. That's his main goal.
Mm-hmm.
And then back down at the bottom of the building, that one cop guy you like is there. They already have, like,
oh,
a bunch of crimes.
Morgan.
Yeah,
Officer
Morgan.
Officer Morgan. Morgan.
Yes. And... he's just like, what do you figure that was about, detective, to Elisa? Because now they've, like, walled the whole, like, building off or whatever, like, with crime tape or whatever.
I couldn't remember if we had seen this scene previously or if this was new to us.
I don't think we saw it previously. I don't know. I don't remember it. No, because it faded out as soon as she saw, like, the claw marks, and she was like, what could do that?
What could make claw marks? Right, yeah. So in this scene, she's saying, like, I don't know. But I'm going to find out.
And then dramatic music, and then we get to be continued.
Yes.
And
so
that
thank
was
God
the entire episode.
Is finally over. This was such a big episode, just in terms of like what happened, and in terms of just like how much characterization they're still giving to all of these characters.
Yeah.
This is another going to be a fucking long episode.
This is probably going to be longer than the first
like,
one. I
would like them to be under an hour, but like, there's so much packed into these early episodes. It's really difficult.
Well, Awakening.
To not talk about
yeah.
Why would you rate this episode?
Oh my
I know
god.
You gave the last one 5 out of 5 loincloths.
Well, I changed the rating, I thought, because it wasn't gay enough.
Oh, did you? What was the new rating for
it was like 4.
That rating? The 4?
I don't know.
Four,
I mean, I'll keep the last one at 5 out of 5 just because it was so cool. This one, I would probably... Okay, last one is like 4.5 out of 5. This one is a straight 5 out of 5
Because this one had the day
it
content that
had
the last episode was
story, it
missing.
had subtext. Just as soon as Xanatos was introduced, it just got like 20,000% more gayer.
Like, he's just so into Goliath.
He's
Like, he
very
wants
into
to
Goliath.
possess him.
He does.
Like, he just wants Goliath to, like, just parade around in a tiny, you know, like the Chippendale outfits? He
Yeah.
wants that for Goliath.
Wait, the
Just like that
Chippendale
collar.
outfits?
What?
You said the Chippendale outfits?
Chippendale. Not the Rescue Rangers.
What? Why is Xanatos like trying to procreate this Rescue Rangers fantasy with Goliath?
Oh my, no, the Chippendale, like Chippendale dancers.
Chippendale. You mean.
Okay, I need to look this up now because I'm pretty sure that is the word for this, isn't
Okay, so you're saying Chippendale is one
It's
word.
all one word, yes.
Oh my god, my head hurts.
Chippendale. Google it. Like,
You sound like
I
my
can't believe you
mom.
made
Oh
me
my
check to see if
god.
this is a real thing. That's what he wants Goliath to look like. That's what he wants his new uniform to be. Except for Goliath,
You
I
could
feel
have
like
just
Xanatos would
said
just have
that
him like in a
he had
bra.
him in like a freaking like a sultry maid outfit and that would have been equivalent.
Okay, well, that's like probably the second date for Xanatos, though.
Okay, that's true.
Yeah,
All
I
right.
think I would give this episode 5 loincloths too, but I'm pretty sure I'm going to give all of Awakening 5 loincloths because I know the whole thing is really, really good.
It really is. So now that we got that out of the way, what would you say the horniest moment in this show, in this episode was?
For me, I would have to go with the time that Broadway like went on his back and lifted up his legs for that one SWAT team guy
Yeah,
and then
like.
just definitely showed his ass. And imagine being that SWAT team guy. Like,
So.
Broadway is just showing you his hold right now. Like, that's literally what is happening. And he
So
just
Broad
like now we know why he charged in so
Broadway's going
fast.
for a 2 for 2 on horniest moment for you.
Yeah, like I know because last time I said Broadway too, but like they keep animating him just very, very
Subtly.
horny. And I can't help being who I am and seeing this. It's not my fault.
That's true. God, I really can't think of like the first thing that comes to mind is just like I think Xanatos, that subtext at the end of the episode with like Xanatos like taking Goliath's hand and talking about like you know just the relationship and stuff and trying to earn trust. But that's like
See, I feel like that's evidence for like the next segment we do, which is who the gayest character is, but it's not necessarily like something that the animators are making
that
horny.
is true. So I'm gonna have
You know?
to. Because I can't really think of any other moments in that episode that are particularly horny other than, just a few upskirt loincloth screenshots I grabbed.
Well, there was the time that like Hakon like fell into the captain of the guard's arms. Like that was pretty nice.
Not as horny as Broadway's whole ass being shown. I'm giving it to
You know,
Broadway.
like I'm trying to like think of alternatives, but yeah, like I think it can only be Broadway's ass here.
Yeah, so Broadway, he has he's on a streak with horny moments, I have to say.
Yeah, like somebody's got to break this. I don't know who it's going to be, but like Broadway is he's really
He's a good boy.
he is a good boy. Like if I had to pitch between like the three of the trio characters to date, it would probably no, it would be Lexington.
Yeah, I was
But
gonna
Broadway would
say.
be a very strong second place though.
Why can't we just date them all?
I feel like that would be the only way to actually date them, is like they're just like a group package.
Yeah, like it's a whole polyamorous thing. Horniest moment was that brief instance where we saw Broadway's bare blue ass. And as for the gayest character,
I mean, I think we know who it's going to
it's
be. Like,
Xanatos. Like, without question.
he was in rare form this episode.
He
just
was.
totally hitting on Goliath, like pretty much from like the first sentence he said.
Every single second he was in this episode, he was
Like
literally.
if he's not trying to get into Goliath's loincloth, like he's making eyes at him, he's insinuating things. Like it's all just
He's
part of
talking about a
his
relationship. He's
Machiavellian.
holding his hand. He's talking about being used by men. Like, there's
But
subtext.
of course, you know, Xanatos isn't like those other men. He'll treat Goliath right.
I'm
He'll give
sure.
him like all he'll give him the most beautiful like satin jock straps that he wants. Set
Satin
him up
jock
in this
straps.
posh palace that he has.
Posh palace.
He's like, "You can defend my castle, bitch boy." If you know what I mean.
Oh, God.
You know, there is the discussing like the myths that the show is referencing, and I thought about doing like a David and Goliath, or talking about the David and
Yes.
Goliath myth, because you know David Xanatos
Yeah,
is
but
his first name is David for that reason, which is something
exactly.
I only connected like a very short time ago.
What?
I did not, however, really research David and Goliath in the Bible for this, so I can't really tell. I
Okay,
can't really say
so
that much about
having been biologically named after that biblical story, I can weigh in on that.
Oh, really?
No, yeah, that's legit. I'm named after David from David and Goliath story.
Is
And
it bad that I forgot what your actual
no,
real first
I'm
name
used to
is?
it by now. Like I'm not David in anyone's eyes really, except for I think Velvet's. But basically the whole story was like this twink boy or whatever was like defending like pretty much the story of Hakon defending or not like Hakon attacking the castle was like Goliath was like in that role and he
Right.
was
So in this case, Hakon would be Goliath and the Vikings would be the Philistine, I guess.
I suppose. And Goliath in the
And then
biblical story
Goliath
was
would
like,
be David. This is very confusing.
listen, I don't know, man. Like there's references, but really all they are is references. There's like it's very there's not really a correlation with the actual story, I think, in terms
There
of
isn't. Yeah, like Goliath in the Gargoyle of Goliath is only named after this biblical figure. As the show goes on, they will directly reference more myths and fairy tales and have those figures like actually show up in the show.
yes.
But it's sort of a stretch to even for this one. Like we want to set up that this segment eventually, but they'll probably wait till we have like better examples. But
Yeah.
yeah, nice. Good episode. How long have you been recording? Do you know?
I have no idea. I split the recording three times, but I'm
I
pretty
feel
sure.
like it's been at least 2 hours. I had a lot to say.
We had a lot to say, but it's been said. That's because there was actual like gay subtext in this episode, and we just needed
There's
to squee
a
about that
lot.
for a lot. And we both had a lot of notes this time.
I guess we should do our outro and say where people can find us.
Yeah.
So as I said at the beginning, I am Manicorn, aka Croup, aka Soup Goblin. You can find me on Twitter under the Manly Unicorn. I'm also on Fur Affinity under the name of Croup if you'd like to see my writing and my furry characters there. Or I'm on Patreon, also under the Manly Unicorn, where I write kink fiction, predominantly male spanking. So if you ever see me talk about spanking while recording this podcast, that's why, because I'm super into that. How about you, Sid?
I can be found on Twitter at SidScripts. I can also be found on Fur Affinity under the username Alistair Alderman, which I do not remember where I got that name from. And there I will post a lot of kinky writing commissions that various people come to me about, as well as my own writing with my own characters, specifically, just rugged male or dad characters that I have. And I'm a freelance writer and editor. If you need something written or edited, or I'm a
Nice.
freelancer, But that's really about it. I don't have as many plugs. I think you should plug your other podcast, though.
Oh, well, okay. So for people who don't know, I was the co-founder of the Dude Spanking Dudes podcast. That was the podcast I was on previously to this one, which was all about spanking fetish content and stuff like that. I am going to be on a new episode of that probably this week sometime. I'm just coming on, I just come on every once in a while now. I'm not a regular anymore. But if you'd like to hear more of me talking, you should check that out as well. I'll probably link it on my Twitter at some point.
Excellent, excellent. All right, well, I
Thank you
think
for
it
reminding me.
is safe to say that we are complete with this episode.
I would say so.
Stay tuned for Awakening Part 3
Yeah.
in mid-April, I imagine. And
Let's see how Broadway can expose his ass this time.
exactly. May all your hopes and dreams come into fruition, fellow viewers. Okay, I'm done.
And cut.
Yes. That was a beautiful outro.